Hello, hello. Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please?
Did I say that right?
Ladies and gentlemen, may he have your attention, please?
Good morning, everybody. I hope you're feeling okay. We're going to do 20 minutes on artificial intelligence. We like to say, but we can't publish, AI is BS. And we're going to talk about why that might be and where AI might be going. My name is Rich Green. I'm an integrator in Palo Alto, California. So I live in the future, and I am an AI. I'm not actually here.
My name is Peter Aylett, and I saw in the news today that many of my clients were bombed today in Saudi Arabia. So that's really great for our business model. But anyway, I'm an integrator, work for a large integration company based in the Middle East. I've known Rich for years and years and years, and we're going to have some fun for the next 20 minutes.
Artificial intelligence is not what you think it is. There's a lot of marketing hype behind it. There are various kinds of AI. This is why it's confusing. So there are three kinds of AI that are in research development right now. The first one is called ANI, Artificial Narrow Intelligence. And that's your typical Alexa, Josh AI. They have a very specific narrow vocabulary and a very specific program. We migrate over the next probably 10 years into what's called AGI, which is Artificial General Intelligence, and that's when the AI starts to mimic a true human mind, and you can have a conversation with it as you would with a real person. That's AGI, and it's many, many kinds of narrow AIs joined together. Then we go to ASI, which is Artificial Super Intelligence, and that's when all the AGIs start joining up in a massive network, and they go beyond human mind.
Skynet.
And then they start improving upon themselves without human intervention. That's when it gets scary.
AI is BS. We have to say it. Rich is going to talk about what the I means in a second. The A we're going to talk about over the next 20 minutes. But really what we want to talk about is when all of these products all around a show floor and all around an industry have that label of AI on them, what does that actually mean? If you go to CES now, every single booth at CES, what's the word it has and it's had for about 5 years above the booth? Smart. Everything is smart. And as far as I'm concerned, once everything is smart, and smart is the baseline, that means that nothing is smart. It's almost like over here an amplifier, someone saying it's an electric amplifier. Well, of course it's an electric amplifier. What other amplifier is there going to be? Everything today is smart. And when people say smart, what they really mean is connected. And what we're going to talk about is when someone says AI, exactly what does that mean?
This is what it means. So there's an academic definition of what intelligence is. Artificial intelligence has two bad words in its name, artificial and intelligence. It is not intelligence. Intelligence is something that is way advanced, and it's only inside a human brain as we typically understand it. It has understanding, self-awareness, it learns, it has emotional knowledge, it has reasoning capability, it can plan for the future. In an evolutionary sense, that's why we were evolved to have intelligence, is so that we could plan to the future and survive. So in order to get to artificial intelligence, we got a long way to go, a lot of context to observe and absorb, and a lot of data to crunch, and then joining multiple minds together. We're not there yet, but it's important to understand what intelligence is. It means it's adaptive, that it's able to predict the future in a matter of survival. Here's another way to look at artificial intelligence. It understands complex ideas. It adapts effectively to the environment. This is really critical. If something weird comes along, it needs to adapt quickly. Not all AIs do that. They just stay there and go, I'm sorry, I don't understand that. Learn from experience. This is machine learning. Engage in various forms of reasoning. We're nowhere close to reasoning yet. Overcome obstacles by taking thought. So then there are different kinds of intelligence. There's emotional intelligence, spatial intelligence, visual intelligence, et cetera. So these are very early days in the artificial intelligence world. That's why we say a lot of the marketing is BS, because they're over-promising what it is.
I want to talk about two really important words when we talk about AI, and that is learn and data. Let me take you to a slightly dark place now and give you a scenario of a child that is born. And that child has no hearing, has no sight, has no touch, has no smell, has absolutely zero sensory input into by far the most powerful computer ever conceived in anything, really.
The universe.
Is that child in the universe, in parallel universes, is that child able to learn? That child cannot learn. The essence of learning is sensors. We need sensors. And you know what? When you look at who we are as an industry, what it is we do in terms of installing technology into buildings and people's homes to enhance the human condition, to make their lives better, so much of what we're doing now is installing sensors. So look at us as being the enablers of the AI future, because what we are bringing to the table is we are bringing the data that is necessary for that AI to work. Without data, AI is going nowhere. Look at Google's acquisition of Nest. Why did Google acquire Nest? Not to be a thermostat company, to be a data company. If you say Amazon to someone, they think Amazon's just a shopping channel. Anyone know what AWS is? Here's a fantastic statistic. Someone told me, hearsay, so don't take this as complete accurate, the BBC host a platform called iPlayer. Anyone want to have a guess at how much the BBC pay monthly to Amazon Web Services for the bandwidth? £17 million. So Amazon Web Services, Amazon are a data company. Facebook aren't a social network. Facebook are a data company. It is these data companies that are going to drive the AI revolution. And what they currently do is machine learning. So really, the reason that AI is BS is that AI really should be called at the moment where we are here and now today with the vast majority of stuff that is an actual reality rather than in a lab. These products use machine learning. Machine learning, the premise of it is the AI, the computing device, is giving a training set of data to say, hey, here's a set of data. Beyond this, try and figure out as much as you can for yourself. Learn. But as Rich said, most of this machine learning, most of this AI is very, very, very narrow. It's specific for a purpose. And what we're going to find that we absolutely need is we need all of these data sets to be joined up. That's when we're going to have real AI, because without the joined up data sets, we don't have the perspective. Again, if you took a child and you locked them in a room for their entire learning and you just fed them a very, very narrow data set of the world, they would not be able to learn. They would not be able to turn into the complete individual. And it's exactly the same with machine learning. We must try and join up those data sets.
Okay, so in order to do what Peter just said, in order for the data sets to join and talk to each other, we need cloud-to-cloud communications, cloud-to-cloud APIs. We're not quite there yet, but they are happening. This is a really funny slide of the anatomy of an AI system, and it covers the whole, you can't read the fine print, it covers the whole ecosystem from power generation in a coal plant all the way out to the utterance from a voice box. So it actually burns up a tremendous amount of power. It takes a lot of rarefied metals. It takes a lot of computing power. It takes a lot of intelligence. So in order for AI to progress, I just want to make the point that this is a gigantic ecosystem across many continents, across many companies. AIs initially are surveillance devices. You all remember the HAL 9000 computer from 2001, A Space Odyssey, 50th anniversary. That is a very prescient movie. And that movie is not as far out as we think. What I suggest you do is you get really stoned and go watch that movie again. And it will change your perspective on things. What is this? This is the Nest thermostat that was created by my buddy Tony Fidel. What is it? It's a surveillance device. It's a way to get data from a family. The key word here is consumer engagement. This is what causes you to stick on a website. This is what causes you to have desire, which causes you to buy things. It's about targeted, micro-targeted advertising. That's the big application of data and machine learning right now, is to get you to buy things.
A really important extension of that is, I think we're about to come into a time where people are going to insist that they own their data. If you divide Facebook's revenue by the amount of users that Facebook has, revenue per user is actually relatively low. So there is arguably a business model to say that Facebook do not accept advertising. Facebook do not accept our data. So I think this whole freemium model that we're in with regards to all these services that we consume in the internet, that's going to be a big conversation. And in terms of us owning our data, rather than just giving our data away for free, data is going to be a very, very valuable commodity.
Data is the new black. Google bought Nest for the acquisition cost of $320,000 per household. You know it wasn't about the thermostat. It was about getting consumer data. So we run the risk of being immersed in the era of artificial stupidity. That's really where we are right now. We're nowhere close to intelligence because it's not adaptive yet. So I want to talk about AI versus IA. Have you heard of IA? It goes back to the 1950s. This is intelligence augmentation. And it starts with this guy, one of my heroes, Doug Engelbart, who, after dropping a bunch of acid in Palo Alto, invented the computer mouse. His mission was to make computing supportive of the human condition, to amplify what humans can do with computers, not replace what people can do. So artificial intelligence strives to replace the human being. Intelligence augmentation strives to enhance the human being. Adam Chire, who co-founded Siri with my friend Tom Gruber, did a presentation, and he said, in this decade, artificial intelligence has produced results that I never thought I would see in my lifetime. Now, that's a statement coming from the guy who invented Siri. He continues to be surprised, so it's advancing very rapidly. And he put up this slide. He said, in the user interface paradigm, we've easily gone past mobility. We're in the post-app era. We are here in the era of the digital assistant. So AIs become digital assistants that move with us through the day. They're like our guardian angel.
And from a CEDIA perspective, that makes the next paradigm, rather than us having the smart home, as AI gets better and better and better, we're going to be moving into the era of the intuitive home with proactive assistants.
So voice is key, is our interface to AI for the most part. And you've probably heard about Google Duplex. This is where Google calls up a pizza shop and says, I'd like to order a pizza, please deliver it to me at this address. And Google was so good at it that the pizza shop didn't know that it was a computer they were talking to. So there was some pushback on that, and Google had to add the phrase, hi, I am the digital assistant for Larry Pexton. I would like to order a pizza for him. And then people calmed down a little bit because they weren't being impersonated. Google now moves. Google is Googling into the future, and that's proactive assistance. And so is Amazon with Alexa. They're Googling into the future. Think about that phrase. How do you find out what's going to happen in the future? That's using predictive analytics and anticipatory algorithms. So we have adaptive automation. Our automation systems learn from our behavior. They allow us to live an autonomous lifestyle where we don't have to execute an app or touch a button on the wall, and they include adaptive social interfaces so they understand what you've been saying over the past week and then build a context around your next utterance so they have better understanding of what you're saying. Amazon's actually doing this. They call it cross-skill action predictors. So if you say, Alexa, book me a movie ticket, typically it just goes and buys you a movie ticket. But now what they're saying is, oh, this person's going to see a movie. Will you be eating out? Let's take you to a restaurant. Would you like a cab or an Uber? Let's get that for you. So that's an example of a narrow form of adaptive AI. Fake. AIs are easily persuaded to be biased because they're programmed by biased people. That's how we slipped into the fake news world, and this is the danger we run in fake AI. Here's a company called Liarbird. Anyone from Australia? You know what a lyrebird is, right? It mimics other birds. Okay, so this company calls themselves Lyrebird. They are mimicking other voices. If the little robot starts speaking in mom's voice, what's the kid going to do about that? They're going to do what the robot tells them. This is very, very scary. In fact, this is terrifying. So this company actually exists, and they make artificial voices for AIs. They can speak in your mother's voice. This company, Lyopa, goes even beyond. They're reading lips now. So the AI can, if you're in a noisy environment like this and it can't pick up with the microphone, it can read your lips. And they're reading lips with very good recognition. This is a shipping product. And look what else they can do. They can read sign language. And as the hand moves across the background, it tracks the hand and it keeps reading sign language. So back to 2001, A Space Odyssey, open the pod bay doors, Hal. Hal starts reading their lips. This is happening right now.
Can I just go back a slide? I think this is a really profound thing to look at for our industry, because one of the questions that we have to ask, and one of the questions that the AI people are going to ask us to do, is exactly how much resolution do we need? If you look at this, this isn't storing or processing full video. It's not looking at a person's face. It's looking at wireframe. And we met a fantastic company at CES, I think it was last year, that was doing gait analysis. So someone's gait is the way they walk. And apparently, someone's gait is more unique than their DNA, because your twin can have the same DNA as you, but gait analysis is unique. So this conversation about how much resolution is necessary, I think, is going to drive the privacy versus data arguments to feed the data sets for AI.
This is a this was announced 2 weeks ago between Microsoft and Qualcomm. It's called the Vision AI Developer Kit. This is AI at the edge. The AI is built into this camera. This camera can look onto a factory floor and figure out if somebody is not wearing a hard hat and identify who they are so that you can reach out and get them their hard hat. That's how precise they're getting. This is AI at the edge. AE is artificial emotion. So AIs have a better chance of understanding us if they understand our emotional state. That builds context around the utterance. So don't make me feel stupid. People feel stupid when they're interacting with stupid AIs. Panoptic pose detection, as Peter was saying, this is an AI that can read body language. It can tell your emotional state from your body language. This is Poppy Crum, chief scientist at Dolby Laboratories. Her research is in artificial emotion. Look at her TED Talk. They're reading the heat map from people's faces, which is an indicator of their emotional state. And they're also smelling your breath. Poppy Crum determined that if you get scared, if you have fear, you exhale more carbon dioxide. So now the AIs are smelling your breath. Okay, when AIs become embodied, when they have agency in the real world and they can move around, that's called a robot. And robots are getting really, really good. Look at Boston Dynamics. Robots can walk down a snowy slope. They can certainly do industrial work, but they're also social robots, service robots that can help people assist in their daily affairs. It's also critical to assistance for the aged. The demographics show that the aging populations are the ones that have the most robot development. So robots are coming from Japan and China and soon from the U.S. because the robots are necessary to help people age in place, just like Ken Erdman is right here. You've heard about Sophia. This is the work of David Hansen. This is a stupid machine, but now she's become a citizen of Russia. People go nuts. They just imbue humanity into these stupid machines. AIs are now getting curiosity built into the algorithm. They're putting randomness into the algorithm, which is what the evolutionary process is. So evolutionary algorithms will allow these AIs to improve upon themselves. Look at this robot. It started out brain dead. It had no algorithm to learn how to walk. It figured it out itself. All they said is do random stuff until you get forward motion. When you get forward motion, maintain that program. And after not too much time, it just gets up and starts walking away. It taught itself how to walk. This is how the AIs will turn into AGIs. They will teach themselves how to get from narrow to general.
And for AGIs to turn into humanity requires imperfection. As humans, the big thing that makes us human are not our brilliant things, but our imperfections. So this level of randomness to introduce a designed level of imperfection into an AI is going to what bridges that gap between AGI and scarily humanity.
Great poem by Richard Brautigan. LSD, Summer of Love, San Francisco, 1967. I like to think it has to be of a cybernetic ecology where we are free of our labors and joined back to nature, returned to our mammal brothers and sisters, and all watched over by machines of loving grace. Can we do this? Can we get there? It's up to us. It's incumbent on us to make sure that AI doesn't kill us, that it helps us, that it helps forward the human cause and the human condition with morals and ethics. We can do this, but if it slips into the wrong hands, we are in deep poop. So we have entered the post-human world. The post-human world is where we start replacing ourselves with machine parts. We become cyborgs. The object here is to live forever. This is what the singularity people want to do. And if you live forever in the network, that is another way of saying heaven. Why are we doing this? Why are we pursuing this?
From a CEDIA perspective, I think we've now entered the post-smart era. Smart is easy, smart is cheap, smart is passe. We as a CEDIA community need to embrace what AI means. We need to understand sensors. We need to understand machine learning. We need to understand how these data sets join together. And critically, we need to understand how to leverage that to actually make our clients' lives better. We are no longer the AV guys. We are the guys that make our clients' lives better using technology, and AI is the single most profound technology that we need to really, really grab hold of in the future.
You cannot understand good design if you do not understand people. This is design thinking. It's the essence of design. It's simplicity. We need to design for the human condition, augment the human brain, and I think we have a hope. This is by Dieter Rams, one of my design heroes. So just remember this. This is always about people, not replacing people, but helping people live a more fulfilled life for now and for 10,000 years into the future. Thank you. Any questions? What's the path to heaven? Well, Larry, you're on it. You tell us. Build a company, sell it to Control 4, and retire happy. That's the path to heaven.
Thank you.